Georgia.
We on the grind in
Georgia
all the time. It ain't nothing on my mind but
Georgia.
We ain't playing with you. We on the.
Okay, hello everybody. If you did not hear our earlier chat, my name is Theodora Lau, and I am the founder of Unconventional Ventures, and I'm here today with my partner in crime, Mr. Brettley Leimer, or Leimer, sorry. I know I'm trying to see if you were paying attention. It's a little inside joke, sorry. And he and I have co-authored a new book called Beyond Good that explores how technology is leading a purpose-driven business innovation in financial services and beyond. And today we are joined by three panelists that we will introduce in a moment. And please do feel free to drop your question in the chat if you have something you would like for us to address later, and do let us know where you are joining us from. Now, let's talk a little bit about where we are today. Nothing reveals the inequality in this world more vividly than what we have collectively experienced the last year and a half. And more often than not, those who need the help the most before the crisis tend to be the most that are impacted, both during or in the aftermath, or shall we say, we're still in the aftermath. Now, with COVID and the resulting economic impact, one in four faced food insecurity in our year of hunger. That's 81 million people in the United States, which is also the wealthiest country in the entire world. Unfortunately, these trends are also not uniquely American. For the first time, economic inequality will likely increase in almost every single country, all at the same time. As Oxfam had recently reported, the 1,000 richest people on the planet recouped their COVID-19 losses in just about 9 months. But it could take more than a decade for the world's poorest to recover from the economic impacts of the pandemic. But as we often say, inequality is not inevitable. It is a man-made problem that can be solved.
Yeah, humans tend to make their own problems, don't they? But during these times of uncertainty, we have this unique opportunity to turn empathy and compassion into lessons of hope, and that was a lot behind the book. We have a chance to take our collective lessons that we experienced during this isolation, including new norms for remote work. We just talked about that a little bit and how we're kind of re-entering the world of work in a different way, how distance learning for our children has really changed our lives. And we have this opportunity to create a genuine connectivity to the needs of each other in a new way. So what change really happened? There were so many different ways that change was sparked during the past 15, 16 months. And if you pay close attention, you'll notice these little sparks all around us. When we were writing the book, we heard so many stories. David Reeling from Sunrise Banks, a B Corporation focused on their community, Amy Millman from Springboard Enterprises, Andre Cherney from Aspiration, Jimmy Chen from Propel. These are founders and community leaders that talked to us about their journey around what it meant for them to go beyond good and to change their business model and be beacons of hope to others. All of these stories share that commonality, purpose, hope, this conviction that fighting for the well-being of humanity and equality in our communities is something definitely worth fighting for. So that's the premise of Beyond Good, is that we can learn from each other and improve every single business model that's existing. You could learn a little bit more about the book itself before we get into the conversation at beyondgoodbook.com. And on that note, let's get into it. We're joined by three amazing panelists to talk more about the role of financial services as we rebuild this economy and how we could all go beyond good. So I'm going to give them a chance to get a warm-up and introduction and tell us about what they're doing and talk to about why companies should focus more on purpose. So Eva, let's start with you. Tell us a little bit about what you're up to.
Thanks, Brad. My name is Eva Csaky, and I spent most of my professional life in trying to foster a more inclusive and climate smart economy. I've worked for almost 20 years for the IFC, the International Finance Corporation, which is the private sector arm of the World Bank in DC. And I've worked in the financial institution or financial services group there which specifically focuses on how can we foster more sustainable economic development through the financial sector, and in particular supporting small businesses, women-owned businesses, and the likes. And my specialization has been in climate smart projects. I spent many years looking at, for example, energy efficiency. How can we help people in low-income housing make their homes more energy efficient? And of course, do that by working with the local financial sector to make that happen and make it happen in a way that is ultimately attractive for the banks and, of course, attractive for the people who are implementing these projects. So my focus has been at the intersection of inclusion and climate. And in my IFC years, I really focused on less developed or developing countries, because that's what is the mandate of the World Bank. And a couple of years ago, I had the opportunity to change course. And now I run the Hunt Institute for Engineering and Humanity in Dallas. And for the first time, I got exposed to issues in the United States. And I learned that those are actually not that different from the ones that I had previously experienced internationally. And poverty, inequality, climate related. So now my work is very much focused globally, both in developed and developing countries, to the extent we still wanna use those fairly useless dichotomies. And Fintech for Good is an amazing and very innovative organization that we have partnered with for many, many years. And just recently, I've been honored to be asked to become the president of the board of Fintech for Good. So I'm here representing both of these organizations.
Oh, that's amazing. Great to hear. Jesse, how about you?
So I actually came from a legal and regulatory background. I'm currently on the general counsel of a company called Steady. Before that, I was with the CFPB, the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, where I'd gone down there to help open up the Office of Enforcement. So I was every banker's best friend. Everyone loved to see me coming in their doors. Parenthetically, nobody wants me coming in their doors now anyway, so maybe it's just me. But I was working there, and eventually I realized that I wanted to go on the other side. Obviously, I believe that government has a strong role, especially in the financial services market, but I wanted to try and see what I could accomplish on the other side. So I went to a lender, a fintech lender. I was working there for years. And then as my sort of awakening continued, I realized that while better credit products are vitally important, especially for the LMI demographic, the low to moderate income, the real challenge is income, right? We can build better products as much as we want, and I strongly encourage every entity to continue to do so. I've seen lots and lots of innovation, which has really done some good. But at the end of the day, if people aren't making sufficient income, the best credit product available isn't going to solve that challenge. So that's what brought me to my current role here at Steady, where we really focus on, I say, the gig economy workforce, but the real reality, and we can go into this in greater depth later, but the gig economy workforce is a bit of a misnomer. I think of it kind of like fintech, in that neither of these words are going to exist in 5 to 10 years, because there's not going to be fintech, because if you're in financial services, you're either using technology or you're not in business. So fintech won't be a category in 5 to 10 years. Just like the gig economy workforce, it is such a massively growing demographic and cohort of the American demographic that in 5 to 10 years, the majority of the American workforce is going to have some fashion of extra income opportunities. And so what we do at Steady is we focus on really on the data. And, I don't want to start using AI and machine learning just to throw it around, but we do use that to help the workers understand what their earning potential is. So we will look at how people earn, what they earn, and then we'll make suggestions and we'll say, hey, there is a group of people that look like you, they have your skill sets, they have your training, and they are making $4 an hour more at this other company. You should go do that, especially on Tuesdays and Thursdays, right? So it's that kind of, it's a platform to help them understand how they earn and where they can earn more.
That makes a lot of sense, and people certainly need to be making more income. We work with a company called Stuvo, which is doing a very similar thing in Steady. Kent, how are you working in this space? Tell us your story.
Yeah, well, I'll give you a little bit about my background. I'm Kent Gregoire. I'm the leader of Symphony Advantage, a consultancy that focuses on conscious capitalism. I have an unusual kind of career in the sense of where I came from. I started my first manufacturing company when I was 14, founded and led more than a dozen organizations. And at that time, success to me was really focused around shareholder value. But as time went on, I understood and started to pivot. I understood the challenges that the private sector was creating for both society as well as our environment. And I wanted to be a part of that change and make sure that all stakeholders' interests were above everyone else. Since then, I've committed 100% of my energy professionally towards conscious capitalism, became one of the first certified conscious capitalism consultants in the world. When I think of fintech and I think of any company, and I know one of the things I wanted to hear about was purpose. Purpose to me is extremely extraordinary in its power to help right organizations when it's done correctly, and employees absolutely are on fire. They get, you know, it's ignited behind the purpose. Extraordinary things happen and they begin to solve really worthy specific problems, whether they be environmental, societal, or the things that they feel are going to make a really big difference so that the world becomes a better place. I think one of the areas that purpose falls really awry is when it's done, of course, in the greenwashing and all the different ways of which happens. But the other part is when companies don't integrate purpose within their entire organization. So they might be saying our purpose is this and trying to address whatever this may be as an initiative versus saying purpose is how we are going to address operationalizing our company, what our processes are, all the things that we do in our organization to work towards solving that really worthy specific problem, you know, to be good, where we are today, from traditional capitalism to a more conscious mindset.
I like that. And I almost wanted to pile on and say that, you know, that should be something that everyone should be doing, right? Every company, mm-hmm. regardless of what industry, regardless of where you are, that needs to be a fundamental DNA to what you're doing, but we'll get to that. So Eva, I'll start with you. You had recently said an inclusive and just society is one where everyone has equal opportunity to succeed and thrive, but most countries have not achieved this goal. And to be honest, I would say we don't have to look too far. Just look at what's happening in the United States and you see the challenges that millions of people are suffering from, as we alluded to, right? And we see it all day today, financial insecurity, food insecurity, digital divide, lack of access to innovation opportunities, right? A lot of the funding still rests upon where you are within the United States, coastal city, what people you know, what school you went to, et cetera. And I just wrapped up a panel right before this, and one of the feelings that we had, collective feeling, maybe a feeling of sigh, but that a lot of these challenges are insurmountable, it feels like. There's so much of it. Where do we start was always the question. Talk to us a little bit about some of the initiatives that you mentioned at Fintech for Good. So first of all, curious to for you to share, where can we find out more about Fintech for Good? And what are some of the things that you are excited about?
Thank you for that question. And well, yes, definitely we have some serious challenges. And I think the most challenging part is the complexity. And we are so siloed oftentimes. We have amazing organizations, but very often focusing on very specific narrow problems. And while that is important and necessary, at the end of the day, when we are dealing with the issues of poverty, inequality, and now all of this is having been made much more complicated with climate change, not to mention globalization, which has been a trend we've been dealing with for now probably 20 years, everything is connected. So it is very hard to tackle challenges effectively unless there is utmost collaboration. And we really need to be thinking of the overall ecosystem. And that is really something that Fintech for Good has been doing for many years, being cognizant of the overall ecosystem, focusing on these issues, if you want to put it in SDG terms or poverty, inequality, but really looking at the impact sector and looking at how can we best leverage Fintech and various blockchain-based technologies to really help tackle the challenges in a holistic and comprehensive way, build the ecosystem, create the connections so that we can look at this in a comprehensive and holistic fashion. And I do believe this is really important because when we, as you said, these are overwhelming challenges, in particular because of their complexity. But at the end of the day, what we are dealing with is the lack of access. I think it all comes down to, you mentioned, you know, education and other things. It's all about access. It starts with something as simple as access to information. And one of the studies that we have done revealed that while there are all these amazing institutions, organizations, and services out there, the people who most need them oftentimes have no idea, right? So even access to basic information is a challenge. And as I was interviewing some of these folks, I was talking to this lady and I asked her like, okay, so you have this challenge. In her case, she actually had, speaking of gig economy, or I think we also need to put on the table this very important topic of informal economy, because the informal sector and informal businesses are representing an increasing share of jobs and livelihoods. And so she was running a reasonably successful informal business, which was a micro business. But as we were having this conversation, she said, you know, my dream would be to actually have a formal business. And I said, so why don't you? I mean, there are all these programs out there that help exactly people like you, minority-owned business, female-owned business in this particular zip code. And she had no idea. And I said, well, how about you just Google it? She had an iPhone. And she said, look, I cannot use anything on this phone besides the phone, music, text messaging, etc. And it just makes you, it's just a short but sad story to show how complex the problems are. So it's not enough to put a program out there to subsidize or to help certain demographics to formalize their business, because they may not even know about, they may not have the means to get that information. They may not have the necessary background and education to use some of the basic technologies. So I think it's really important as we start talking about these complex problems that we recognize the complexity of the challenge and we recognize the importance of the ecosystem building and mapping, diagnosing what's going on. And of course, that's gonna be different to some extent in every locality, but the different geographies are also connected to each other. So that's where I feel that we still have a lot of work done, and that's really where Fintech for Good and the institute that I'm running to are both focusing.
That's interesting. You know, I think we talk about open banking and embedded finance and different, you know, models that have arrived, but I think certainly open opportunities of different kinds would really be helping Fintech for Good. And I've got gardeners outside the house, so you might hear that in the background. Could I switch a little bit in terms of open opportunities in the context of Beyond Good? Let's talk about the changing nature of work. And Jesse, I'm going to go with you on this one and talk about the gig economy or the shifting nature of work and working at home and all the challenges there. It's often termed as the future work, and it sounds so positive. It's very much here. It's already here. The opportunities to serve changing demographics around the way that we work is very, very immense. And this group, even people that are solo entrepreneurs or new company founders, are not served still well by traditional financial services. So how can the industry do better? How can fintech do better? And how can banks be involved? You want to talk about this one a little bit more in your context with Steady there, Jesse?
Absolutely. So the talking about the gig economy is somewhat interesting. And honestly, I think it reflects, it's a good little microcosm of the American workforce today, in that it's a very, there really are two different economies in America. And I'm absolutely not the first person to say this, nor do I find this particularly groundbreaking, but there is that educated white collar section of the workforce, and they exist in the workforce writ large. They also exist within the gig economy. There we would call them freelancers. Then there is the other half of the economy, which is the more hourly pay, the less highly educated workforce, who are also working in that gig economy. So we always have to be careful when we talk about the gig economy. There is no one gig economy. It really is just a conglomeration of lots of different people. And frankly, one of the biggest challenges right now is, how do you regulate that particular demographic? Because you have people who are gig workers by choice. They want the freedom. They genuinely appreciate it. They feel, rightly or wrongly, that it benefits them, and they are happy with that independence. Then there are others within the gig economy who are there not by choice necessarily, but by requirement, because they cannot find good, decent living wage with a full-time job. So it's very hard to understand that workforce unless you understand it encompasses all of those people. So when you do that, you know, just to also put a sort of size on it, it is, the numbers vary depending upon who you ask, but it's roughly about 57 million gig workers right now, which is about 36% of all U.S. workforce. And that there are some people who are using gig jobs to create basically a basket of income. All of their income is coming from gig jobs, not necessarily one particular gig. And then there are others who are just, you know, traditional, I've got an extra free evening, I want to go drive for Lyft and make some extra money. So again, you just have this, you have this wide variation in the types of people who participate in the gig economy, and then the way that they work in the gig economy. The only thing I'm certain of, it's a massive demographic and it is massively growing. And with that comes a whole host of challenges, from unemployment insurance, right? So forever, only W-2 employees had access to unemployment insurance in America. The CARES Act recently expanded that to 1099 workers. But as a for instance, none of the state unemployment insurance systems can actually receive information on 1099 workers, right? So they're all designed to receive a W-2, and the systems work, you know, we'll say they work adequately for that purpose. But for 1099, none of the systems exist to allow them to actually apply. The funding mechanisms aren't there. So that creates a host of policy challenges for America. We could afford to sort of leave them out on their own for many, many years. It's such a large part of the workforce now. We just can no longer afford to leave them, you know, just on their own devices. And then, you know, when you look at it, many of I'll call them full-time employees, but I mean, if you were to look at the app for Walmart, for the employees there, their like scheduling app looks an awful lot like Uber, right? So even the traditional W-2, you know, they've had just-in-time manufacturing for many, many years. We've now moved into a period of just-in-time human capital and human resources scheduling. So even the overall economic numbers, they can be somewhat misleading, because while there may be people who are in the workforce, there's a much larger category of them who are in the workforce but not receiving sufficient hours, right? So they are employed, but they are underemployed. That's a big challenge. And then, you know, when you get to the actual specific problems, some of the easiest ones to sort of identify is just look at traditional underwriting. You know, the American dream is to own a house. We have been told that every day since we were born, and I don't see that message changing anytime soon. That's all well and good if you've got a W-2. Every bank in America knows how to underwrite you if you have steady W-2 income. What happens if you don't? What happens if you're a 1099 worker, you have uneven income? That is a big challenge for banks and financial institutions to underwrite. So that is one of the challenges that I think everyone is going to have to address. And banks are starting to get much better. They're using alternative data. I mean, personally, one of the bigger, I don't even know if I want to call it an innovation, but one of the things that fintech has facilitated is, you know, cash flow underwriting, pure cash flow underwriting. That to me is making, you know, it's moving the needle on underwriting people that banks could not historically underwrite, because they're not looking at a credit score. And I mean, all you have to do is look at the pandemic to see the challenges of a credit score. So we had millions of people out of work during the pandemic, yet the overall consumer debt load went down because people didn't have a job, but they weren't going out and they were using the government stimulus to pay down their consumer credit lines. That was absolutely unexpected to me. I thought we were going to see credit cards that were going to really start to pull back, but it just didn't happen because people were paying down their debts. So the ability to use the cash flow underwriting is sort of a material improvement. One of the other biggest challenges, though, as everyone can probably imagine, is the benefits, right? When you're in America, our economic security and well-being is largely tied to our employment, whether that's health insurance, whether that's retirement savings, investments. So we are in a period of time where we are going to have to disconnect those two, like employment and retirement savings are just going to have to be disconnected. You know, I'm not sure that I know what the future will look like in that. If I did, I'd be making a lot more money, and I'd make sure you guys had all invested. But there are lots of innovative solutions out there focusing on that. But that is a really big issue. And then one of the other things is just, it is more complicated to be a 1099 worker to understand your earning when you're not earning from one steady paycheck, to understand your expenses related to that earning, especially as a 1099 worker who can write off some of that on their taxes. So one of the other areas that fintech is resolving and needs to continue to resolve is just the understanding of the finances behind people not earning W-2, because it is more challenging. One of the other things I just want to throw out there, which is tangentially related, but I always find it fascinating, is UBI. These universal payments. Our company happens to be working with the mayors for guaranteed income, and there's lots of tests going on. What impact does having a steady required payment due to people? The early returns are showing lots of promise. I don't know where it's going to go, but I have always found that as a fascinating tool to keep people off unemployment. There are lots and lots of other issues, especially with fintech, but those to me are really three of the biggest that are facing the gig economy workers, using that phrase broadly.
Yeah, we literally, in the last session when I was talking to a few of the founders, one of the things that we did talk a lot about is in the United States, like you mentioned, all the benefits are tied to your work, right? So if you're even if you're working, a lot of companies do not offer those retirement benefits. And so when you keep slicing and slicing, it's like, and then you have a social safety net that is cheesecloth. And then we wonder why people end up where we are right now. But Kent, let's move to you. When you were doing your intro, I picked up a few words which absolutely do resonate. We do hear a lot of conversations, and we see a lot of conversation announcement, especially around, you know, the Earth Day and all of that, that, you know, environmental, social, corporate responsibility, governance is very important, and we are going to do X, Y, Z. Yesterday, I saw a cartoon that showcased all the CEOs making those statements. And then next to it is an empty clean plate, which talks about this is the effort it takes to talk about what you're going to do instead of actually doing what you're going to do. So when it comes to promises and actions, we pinkwashing, greenwashing, rainbow washing, all of that, it continues. How do we move from statements, wonderful speeches and promises from Davos, to actually holding companies accountable for what they are supposed to be doing?
Well, I think the first thing is, you know, holding companies accountable has really not worked well in terms of regulation. So when we take a look at consumers, they're already starting to do that work. We're all doing it by voting with our dollars. But I kind of want to go back to ESG's social programs or social and corporate governance programs and other kinds of programs. One of the challenges in organizations is that they're really an initiative and they're tremendous work and great value that's being done. But the challenge is going back to higher purpose, the connection with all of the employees, and that it's integrated, that the purpose is integrated within the company so that they're actually doing the work. It's a part of what they're doing. It's not a second thought or a second conversation going on. Once it becomes a second conversation going on, it's another initiative that gets some traction and sometimes then fails. And I think that's the, you know, the examples of, you know, what you were speaking about. The thing that's going to cause companies to begin to move, and if it's the reason they do it, they'll fail. However, a compelling reason to begin to move toward more purpose-driven, being that stakeholder capitalism company, is that purpose-driven companies outperform traditional peers. If we look, for example, at the S&P 500, over a 10-year period by as much as 400%. Those are not new numbers, and they're, you know, heavily validated numbers. So it's extremely extraordinary that doing good is very profitable. One of the ways they get the profitability is by getting the entire stakeholders to work together toward it. They're not spending the money on marketing, and they're creating a lot more innovation, a lot more value to be able to deliver and extract that value naturally from the marketplace. It is extraordinary. I know that we have a more global audience in some cases, but there is a stat that I think is interesting, and it's fairly recent. 7 in 10 Americans believe business has an obligation to address issues, social issues, and environmental issues that have gone wrong. You know, 7 in 10, and in some countries, that number is actually almost 10 out of 10. So, you know, there's real movement, but it's going to take a combination of things. I've also seen, in having spoken with some groups and doing some informal research, that more and more people are looking for places to work where the cultures are caring and kind. They have the opportunity to really learn, to grow, to develop and grow. They want to be in that environment because they understand that it's not only good for them while they're at work, but they get to thrive in their lives.
Oh, absolutely. I couldn't say anything more than that, because we interviewed so many people in so many companies that really had that as their center core of what they were giving back as part of their business model. And I think it definitely resonates with so many. And I think 7 out of 10 is a great figure, but do people really vote with their wallets? We need more conscious capitalism, as you say. Yeah. We're going to wrap, but we want to thank both Fintech South for hosting this conversation and for all of you, Eva, Jesse, and Kent, for coming on and sharing your views. I want to wrap with this one question. If there were one or two things that really gave you hope, that gave you hope that we're going to have a more inclusive financial services system going forward, whether it's things that are happening now in terms of the businesses that you work with or the way that consumer behavior changes. Let's just end with that. What are your hopeful pieces going forward? Ken, I'm going to go backwards and go with you first.
Well, you know, conscious capitalism was really brought about because the belief that capitalism is an effective tool for righting where we're at. And, you know, the one thing that I continue to find extraordinary in feedback is when audiences, in particular executives, begin to understand what ethics really means, and that ethics comes to people and it's not an abstract idea. And you can't have a conversation about business without ethics and ethics without business. It sounds like that would be an unusual place to cause a movement of individuals changing. It's been my experience. It does. And I'm seeing it firsthand, and that's giving me some really good hope.
And then Jesse, how about you? Final thoughts.
Well, I can very easily tie it into what Kent was just talking about, especially with respect to the human capital. In terms of, I manage hiring for our company, and I can tell you it's a material component is, what are we doing? Are we advancing something positive for society? The people who apply to Steady want to know that. The people who stay at Steady know that. And frankly, there are other places that do not have that mindset. And I know they have to pay their employees more, right? There are places that other millennials do not want to work. If they want those people to come work there, they're going to have to pay them more. And so it really is, it's tied directly to the bottom line. This is why I'm tying it. I see so many young people that I hire, they want to work for something good. They understand it's for profit, it's business. They want to do something that's going to advance the good. And frankly, if we can continue to give that to them, we are going to outperform.
Absolutely, 100% agree with you. Eva, final thoughts and words of hope and encouragement. What do you see going forward that gives you that hope?
Thanks. My optimism is grounded in the fact that I have seen it happen. 20 years ago, we did energy efficiency financing for low-income housing internationally in developing countries. You know, when you have the homeowners saving on their utility bill, which for low-income families can be a very significant cost. Their homes are being more comfortable, the families are healthier, and the banks are making money because the NPL, the non-performing loan rates, are extremely small if you do it right. So we have all these best practices out there. They are just not well known enough. And we actually made it a point to develop a database of these. We have right now 418 of them. And I find that when you share these examples of how things have worked in other places, of course, it's not cookie cutter. You cannot just super copy something. But these examples really inspire, motivate, and inform new interventions. So I've seen it work over the last 20 years. I think we have lots of best practices, which are pretty much low-hanging fruits to be implemented and replicated in a modified fashion, in a way it makes sense in another geography. So that makes me optimistic. I think if we don't do anything else, just focus on trying to replicate already established successful best practices, I think we can accomplish just from that a whole great deal. So that's my final thought on that.
I like that. So there you have it. We have a playbook. We have past experiences. We have the will and we have the tech. So there's absolutely no excuse to do better. Thank you so much for joining us today on the panel. And thank you to Fintech South and for our guests, Eva, Jesse, and Kent. Thank you all.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Georgia.